Hello, everybody, and welcome to round number 3, where I, MysterE, go toe-to-toe with Dr. Jordan B. Peterson. So today I've picked a very interesting episode as he tries to again debunk Marx's analysis of capitalism. The video is called Marxism Debate, Is Profit Theft? Question mark. How appropriate. So this one's got about 23,000 views and it was uploaded about 4 months ago. So I'm sure it's going to be thrilling and I'm sure he's going to give us a very unbiased and objective viewpoint as to why Marx got everything wrong and we should all drop his economic analysis of the world and all of his theories. So without further ado, let's get into it.
So then the next problem is the criticism of profit. It's like, well, what's wrong with profit exactly? What's the problem?
What's wrong with profit?
Well, the idea from the Marxist perspective was that profit was theft.
Wrong.
But profit.
What? Sorry, let's just see where he goes with this.
Well, it can be theft because crooked people can run companies. And so sometimes profit is theft, but that certainly doesn't mean that it's always.
Don't know where he's getting this from. Okay, so like. Yeah, he's trying to say here that Marx said the profit is theft. Look, if Marxists, so people that have gone after him, have made this line that profit is theft, I don't know if he's trying to say that Marx said this specifically, but I think what he's talking about is the idea that capitalism is exploitative. So when you have a capitalist and then a worker, their relationship is one founded on exploitation. So that does not directly correlate or directly equal, okay, exploitative relationship over here must mean that profit is theft in all cases. That is a false premise. Marx was talking about the fact that in the capitalist system, okay, the capitalist system is predicated on wage labor. So people use their labor or exchange their labor for a wage. Let's think of the kind of cliched factory system. You have a capitalist in control of an industry and they engage workers and pay them a wage to produce values for them. Now, they obviously, in order to make profit, they have to pay the worker less than the value that they produce. Now let's just look at this objectively here. If you pay someone less for the value that they produce and you have rights over all of that surplus value, that additional value on top of what they're being paid for, you're taking advantage of that situation for good or for bad. That is a form of exploitation. So I think that's where he's trying to draw this very exaggerated statement here that profit is theft because it's stealing from the worker. Fine. If you want to use that term, go for it, Peterson. But it's based on an exploitative relationship on an objective level of analysis. Got nothing to do with things being good or evil, which is what using a word like theft does. It exaggerates things and makes this an ethical question. That's not what Marx was doing. But look, let's just let Dr. Peterson go on his ramble here.
What it means, in part at least, if the capitalist is adding value to the corporation, then there's some utility and some fairness in him or her extracting the value of their abstract labor, their thought, their abstract abilities, their ability to manage the company and to engage in proper competition and product development and efficiency and the profit.
Marxism has never been about whether it's fair that someone who owns business should, because of their, you know, mental capacities, be able to take all the profit away. It's got nothing to do with that. It's got to do with, like I said before, whether the exploitative relationship is one that is justifiable or not, the exploitative relationship, not whether somebody's ability to start a business and be good in business and all that sort of stuff, whether that's fair or not. That's a distortion, again, of Marx's analysis of capitalism. And this is what Peterson does continually and very effectively, because he's convinced a lot of people that Marxism is evil using this line of argumentation. It's manipulation. That's what it is.
Proper treatment of the workers and all of that. And then if they can create a profit, well, then they have a little bit of security for times that aren't so good. And that seems absolutely bloody necessary.
This is the story, the fairy tale.
Well, how can you grow if you don't have a profit? And if you have an enterprise that's valuable and worthwhile, and some enterprises are valuable and worthwhile, then it seems to me that a little bit of profit to help you grow seems to be the right approach. And so
Marx analyzed this too. He talked about competition between businesses and capitalists, and like the various laws of coercive competition. What Peterson is doing here is making us sympathize with the business owner, because it's hard to be a good business in the capitalist system. Well, that's the problem of capitalism. If the market is so hard for businesses to survive and make profit, that's a problem of capitalism. That's got nothing to do with what Marx was talking about.
And then the other issue with profit, and you know this if you've ever run a business, is it's really useful constraint. You know, like, it's not enough to have a good idea. It's not enough to have a good idea and a sales and marketing plan, and then to implement that and all of that. That's bloody difficult. Like, it's not easy to have a good idea. And it's not easy to come up with a sales marketing plan. And it's not easy to find customers and satisfy them. And so if you allow profit to constitute a limitation on what it is that you might reasonably attempt, it provides a good constraint on wasted labor. And so most of the things that I've done...
Marx was talking about this too. Marx talks about how capitalists, because of the laws of competition, which is, I think, is what he's rambling on about, is that it finds labor-saving opportunities. It continually looks to increase the productive capacity of its technology to squeeze more and more out of labor. I think Peterson is on the same page with Marx about this one, that a savvy capitalist would be looking to get as much as they can out of the labor that is going into their business. What is he going on about? It's a mystery.
In my life, even psychologically, that were designed to help people's psychological health, I tried to run on a for-profit basis, and the reason for what that was, apart from the fact that I'm not averse to making a profit, partly so
I'm
my
sure you're not
can grow, but was also so that there were forms of stupidity that I couldn't engage in because I would be punished by the market enough to eradicate the enterprise. And so,
how incredibly insightful, from Peterson. You have to be good at business to survive in the capitalist market. It's a problem of capitalism. It's got nothing to do with what Marx is talking about. Would you like a pat on the back because you're a savvy businessman?
Okay, and then so the next issue, this is a weird one. So Marx and Engels also assume that this dictatorship of the proletariat, which involves absurd centralization, the overwhelming probability of corruption and impossible
corruption. Because corruption never happens in a free market setting, does it? Hey, Peterson? Hey? Never heard of corruption in the free market.
Proletariat now try to rationally compute the manner in which an entire market economy could run, which cannot be done because it's far too complicated for anybody to think through.
Here's another distortion and manipulation here. When were the proletariat, like the dictatorship of the proletariat, supposed to run things and try to predict what a free market would need to function? The idea of a proletarian revolution when they take control is not to replicate a free market. What are you talking about?
The next theory is that somehow the proletariat dictatorship would become magically hyperproductive. And there's actually no theory at all about how that's going to happen. And so I had to infer the theory, and the theory...
That's dangerous. He's inferring stuff. Before he starts to infer something, let's just touch on that. Okay, he's saying that, when they take power, the workers, that is, they're just going to be more productive than the free market could ever be. And this is based in nothing. Well, look, Marx covered for that too. He didn't want to predict how exactly this system was going to unfold, what was going to happen after the revolution, because he's not a prophet. But the idea is that when you give workers control because they understand their workplaces and they're able to plan for things, then they can plan for productivity and try and deliver on what is necessary in the market at that time, instead of leaving it up to the anarchy of the market. Again, here's another good distortion for you from our friend Dr. Peterson. But I keep interrupting him. Let's see what he has to say.
It seems to be that once you eradicate the bourgeoisie because they're evil, and you get rid of their private
they're
property,
evil.
And you eradicate
cheap shot
motive, then all of a sudden, magically, the small percentage of the proletariat who now run the society determine how they can make their productive enterprises productive enough so they become hyper-productive. Now, and they need to become hyper-productive.
Why?
For the last error to be logically
coherent. Why? Right, that doesn't make any sense.
The Marxist theory, which is that at some point the proletariat, the dictatorship of the proletariat, will become so hyper-productive that there'll be enough material goods for everyone across all dimensions.
And okay, he's dipping into communism here.
Spontaneously engage in meaningful creative labor, which is what they had been alienated from in the capitalist horror show.
Horror.
The utopia would be magically ushered in. But there's no...
Okay, see the language he's using here? The utopia. You know, it's funny because Marx considered himself a scientific socialist and hated utopianism. But like, you know, let's not let the facts get in the way of a good story. Thanks, Peterson. What he's starting to describe here is that after the workers take control of the economy and they're hyper-productive, this will lead to a communistic style of living where, because of how efficient production is, people's needs will be met and they will be liberated from their ties to the economy. They won't have to sell themselves for a wage or have to be partaking in a planned economy all the time, and they can use that time to do other human endeavors. That's communism in a nutshell. But let's see how he tries to warp this one.
About how that hyperproductivity is going to come about, and there's also no understanding that, well, that isn't the utopia that is going to suit everyone, because there are great differences between people. And some people are going to find what they want in love, and some are going to find it in social being, and some are going to find it in conflict and competition, and some are going to find it in creativity, as Marx pointed out.
Yes, but as he pointed out, thank you.
That will necessarily be the end goal for the utopian state is preposterous. And then there's the Dostoevskian observation.
No, it's not preposterous, okay? Like, I don't think any communist ever has said that a communist society will be able to meet everybody's whims and personal tendencies. What communism is about is giving people an economic basis, so like meeting their subsistence levels, so they don't have to go and work just to survive. They can have that stuff catered for, and then they can deal with other human problems, like these ideas of love and creativity that he was going on about there in his little romantic tirade just then, and painting this picture that you could never understand what was needed to make everybody happy in a utopia. It's got nothing to do with creating a society where like everybody's nice and happy and they're completely fulfilled. Humans have human problems. Okay, let's all just acknowledge that. He should know this. He's a psychologist. However, we don't need to add to that by putting them under economic pressure and making them survive on a daily basis through some type of wage labor system. That's what the utopia is, getting rid of people's economic pressures. That's it. He's distorting things again, but you know, classic Dr. Peterson.
Which is one not to be taken lightly, which is, what sort of shallow conception of people do you have that makes you think that if you gave people enough bread and cake, in the Dostoevskian terms, and nothing to do with except busy themselves with continuity of the species, that they would also all of a sudden become peaceful and heavenly. Dostoevsky's idea was that, you know, we were built for trouble. And if we were ever handed everything we needed on a silver platter, the first thing we would do is engage in some form of creative destruction.
Okay.
So something unexpected could happen.
Let's go with this creative destruction and people are built for problems. Okay. Let's go with that, because that's what you want to build your argument on. All right. So why the hell would we be satisfied with an economic system that it's built around the motivation being profit only? So profit is what drives everyone, and they're problematic and they're looking for creative destruction, and we allow them to just seek profit ruthlessly over and step over each other. If people are really problematic, as he's saying, in this way, they're malicious, then why the hell would we want to stay in a system, again, where everyone just focuses on profit and the next profit and the next one? That is an incredibly dangerous system to be living in. Interesting, Peterson.
And just so we could have the adventure of our lives. And I think there's something to be said for that.
My clap, please. Oh, I love the music. It's the best part. All right. What do we learn here? Well, apart from the fact that Peterson repeatedly just distorts Marx and uses false premises to start on as a kind of a stepping stone for him to create his own perspective on what Marxism means, when it has nothing in reality to do with what Marx was talking about, it's really just him trying to manipulate what Marxism is about. Because, you know, as we've discussed already, there's two things I think that's going on here centrally when it comes to Peterson and Marxism. One, Marx was an academic and has been an incredibly influential figure in human history. And Peterson wants some street cred too, so he just loves bashing Marx. I think he thinks that it's going to elevate him into a position where he is the antithesis of Marx and then puts him up on a high standing where he'll be remembered for the rest of human history. I think that is very unlikely. And two, he's a psychologist and he's a self-help guru, and he also gets attacked on campuses and shut down by cancel culture and all that sort of stuff. So he is upset that there is an ideology out there like Marxism, which gives fuel to the people that he has problems with in society, people that are like nihilistic, and use Marxist analysis as an excuse to blame all of their problems on the system instead of being responsible citizens, etc., etc. And so he's got this massive chip on his shoulder about Marxism, and he's going to spend his life now, by the look of it, trying to debunk Marxism. And this is particularly problematic, I think, because what Marxist analysis is trying to do is trying to kind of explain exactly what the problems are with society based on the contradictions, so the internal issues within capitalism. And him just attacking Marx over here and saying, hey, don't listen to that guy, he's got no idea what he's talking about, this is unproductive for us as a species. We should be looking to progress, and we should be looking at people's ideas like this and not taking them out of context and manipulating them. We should be understanding them and then using that to make informed decisions about where to go next. And he's undermining that. So he is kind of, he's not adding to the human race by doing all of this. That's all I'm trying to say here. So look, until next time, we'll pick another good one. But thanks for watching. Please like and subscribe. And remember, I am, you are, we are a MysterE.